association with Crossword Bookstores. We welcome you. And I'd also like to highlight for our celebration this evening our very special guest from Rupa Publications, the Managing Director, Mr. Kapish Mehra. Thank you very much, Kapish, for joining us this evening. Before we get into a conversation a little later with Kangana Ranaut, ladies and gentlemen, and all you avid readers, fans of Chetan, okay, Chetan is giving us the latest update on Kangana. You're going to find the one Indian girl coming very shortly and joining us in conversation. Just happens to be caught in a bit of the traffic of the city of Mumbai. She's gone past Jogeshwari is the update, and she would be down here with the status of Goregaon any moment from now. But may I steal the opportunity as I welcome Chetan, and as I take you through, for those of you who would like to know a little bit more about the work of Chetan Bhagat, he's the author of 6 blockbuster books. These include 5 novels, which most of you are aware of, 5 Point Someone, One Night at a Call Center, The 3 Mistakes of My Life, 2 States, Revolution 2020, in the non-fiction titles, What Young India Wants, and he also has another novel, Half Girlfriend, which was released in 2014. Chetan's books have remained bestsellers since their release. 4 out of his 5 novels have already been adapted into Bollywood films and have been very successful. May I hear you put your hands together for Chetan's success through the years. From the reviews, the New York Times calls him the biggest selling English language novelist in India's history. Congratulations to that, Chetan. Time magazine has named him among the 100 most influential people in the world. And Fast Company USA has listed him as the world's 100 most creative people in business. Most of you have been following his columns on The Daily with English and the Hindi newspapers. He's also a motivational speaker and a screenplay writer. And above all this, he lives in Mumbai with his wife, Anusha. She here with us. A very special guest this evening in conversation with Chetan Bhagat, Kangana Ranaut. Please put your hands together to receive our very special guest at the table, Indian film actress, recipient of several awards, including 3 national awards and the Filmfare Awards in 4 categories. That's Kangana for us. Very savvy with the media, expressing her honest opinions, and of course, credited as one of the most fashionable celebrities. Thank you very much, Kangana, for joining us this evening. On behalf of Crossword, I'd like to now invite the CEO of Crossword, Mr. Kinjal Shah, to kindly join us and present to our very special guest this evening, along with the author, a token of appreciation. We have a gift hamper from Yellow, which is the premium stationery brand of Crossword Bookstores. On behalf of Crossword, a warm welcome. Thank you very much, Kangana, for joining us this evening here in association with Crossword Bookstores and the Oberoi Mall for the launch of One Indian Girl from Chetan Bhagat. Chetan, all the very best.
We launched a new stationery line, so especially for you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Kapish, thank you.
Kapish Mehra, the Managing Director of Rupa Publications, thank you so much.
Thank
you,
friends.
On behalf of Crossword, I present to you the CEO, Mr. Kinjal Shah.
Thank you, Chetan. I think all your fans, all your customers are expecting to read this book. I'm sure you'll get a lot of fillers today. Thank you, friends, for giving this time and patience and listening to Chetan now and then Kangana. Thank you and best wishes on the book to Chetan.
Our pleasure, Kinjal. Thank you so much. Well, we had a little bit of the interaction along with Chetan. Kangana, thank you for joining us this evening. We'd like to hand it over to you to share a few words. Well, I'm told that you've gone through the book already. And so before we get into the delight of the conversation, for you to just share with us your overall view of being associated with the book launch. Thank you so much.
Hi, everyone.
Can you hear her?
Keep it really close. You guys hear me? Okay, so... No, I think this is okay. This is okay, right? This is fine, huh? Okay, so I've read the book and I'm sure everyone's going to love it. And it's a very special book. It's a very human take on a woman's life, a working woman's life. Today's girls who are struggling with their professional lives and personal lives, and it's a lot more endearing and a lot more meaningful because it is coming from a man. That's what makes it very special. And I've become a Chetan Bhagat fan all over again after this book. And when I read it, I was in tears. Actually, a few things pushed me to, made me very emotional because they sounded like, you know, like a leaf out of my own book. So, my own experiences. So, well, I think we should, I should ask Chetan a few questions and...
What we are going to do is, rather than make it very boring book launch type, the plan is she'll ask me one or two questions, I'll ask her one or two questions, and then we'll try to be honest and answer them. If Kangna feels comfortable, maybe we'll take one or two questions from you guys, but you have to ask nice, good questions, okay? And then we'll read a little bit from the book, only a little bit, okay? How does that sound? Sound like a plan? Yeah?
Okay.
Okay. So, you want to ask me first? Okay.
Yeah, because I think, because I love the book, I have a lot to ask. And we didn't meet before this because I wanted it to be a very spontaneous conversation. So, this book mostly talks about how a woman who's given equal opportunities like a man, you know, today we are talking about gender equality and all of that and how we deserve equal opportunity. As a matter of fact, but when we give our women that, they are deprived of their basic feminine rights like love, care, trust, and nurturing, right? That is what the book largely talks about. So I want to ask Chetan that at some point, you know, because he's a married man, he's been in several relationships. So at some point, did he feel... No, but I know.
Yeah.
Okay, so at... Guys, I'm playing an interviewer for the first time. Please cooperate.
Okay. No.
Did he at any point feel insecure of a woman's success, his woman's success, or he felt jealous and competitive of his own partner?
Or straight away you ask me such a difficult question.
No, but let's come to the point. You know, no point moving, you know, beating around
the bush. I
thought
she's going to ask me, how are you feeling today, book launch and all. She's asking me if I have felt insecure. I think it's a very good question. Because the book talks about this woman and how her boyfriends become insecure of her success. And so she's asking me, tell me honestly if as a man I have been insecure. Well, I have a very overachiever wife actually. She's smarter than me and in many ways. And she's also an MBA from IIM Ahmedabad. She was working in a bank. And there were points at which she got promoted, I didn't get promoted. There were points her salary was higher than mine. So initially I did get insecure, initially I did feel that way, but I realized that it's very difficult because she will continue to do well. So how long can I feel this way? Then I thought ki chalo maza hi le lete hain, abhi tum naukri karo, I'll leave and become a writer. I said, you know, ek aadmi agar apni ego gira de na to bahut aage badh sakta hai. To maine kaha meri koi ego nahi hai, aap please naukri kijiye, main ghar baithunga. So that's how that career switch happened. But you're right, it has happened. And then I check myself, especially when I left my job. I remember people used to come to my house and say, "Acha, to aap ghar baithte ho?" Because writer ka kaam koi kaam nahi manta hai. "Acha, books likhte ho? To kaam kaun karta hai?" "Acha, madam office jati hai." Acha, Mrs. aapki office jati hai aur aap kya karte ho pura din?" Maine kaha main kahani sochta hu. Kahaniyan sochte ho baith ke? So, you know, I started feeling insecure. I said, "Arre yaar, main kaise, main bhi aadmi hu, main bhi kuch karu." But, you know, abhi...
But isn't it amazing that he utilized that situation to his...
Make a story.
Yeah, no, to his advantage. Rather than getting jealous and, you know, letting the relationship fall apart and not letting the woman go ahead of him. I think he deserves a round of applause for this.
Thank you.
Chetan, you are our modern, shining, modern man. You are an example of shining modern Indian man. So we are very proud of you.
Thank you. Ab Kangna ne mujhse difficult question pucha. I should also ask difficult, no? Easy or difficult? Difficult, okay? So mera bhi bouncer aayega abhi. So what I want to know, in fact you yourself just said ki you cried at many times in the book because this was a leaf out of your life. These relationships, this girl has, it reminded, at least it made you connect to or relate to something of your past. Now, I don't want, like, we are not looking for gossip here, but you are a woman who's working and who is also a woman who's tried to love and get love like any normal person. So where in this book did you feel that it has happened to you? Has it happened to you that men have become insecure about your success? Has your success actually been a penalty for you?
Well, this is a very, it's like
अब आपने पूछा तो हम भी पूछें।
मेरे जख्मों पे नमक छिड़क दिया आपने। No, seriously, I think this is a very sensitive topic. Any working woman would relate with me that when we are not successful, when I was not doing well, and I was dating men more successful than me, I felt like I was devalued. I felt like I was not given my due as a woman, as a partner. I was not acknowledged, and men behaved borderline indifferent. So that gave me more motivation to do well. Just how it works for men, you know, like you know a certain woman and you want to be worthy of her, right? For okay. whatever reason, for a better companion, for a better future, for a stable future, you know, you want to do well for yourself, not just for a partner, but why you want to move ahead in life and be successful. We have the same reason as men do, like, you know, so you want to be worthy of your partner. And usually for a man it works. You know, when he acquires a certain social stature and he goes up to the same woman who's not, doesn't want to acknowledge him, or, you know, doesn't want to, you know, accept him, it works for him. But in a woman's case, it works the other way around. I've felt in my relationship that my success have always gone against me. You know, like there is a certain, okay, here's an analogy. My analogies are usually a bit weird, but I think when I was not successful, men behaved more like a hard to please father figure, you know, like hard to please. But when I became successful, they behaved more like an evil, jealous sibling. You know, like I felt like they will put my closet on fire. They were jealous of my fashion sense also, you know, like everything was about competing with me, you know, like, oh, you're doing this, look at me. You know, you achieved this, okay, let me blow my trumpet anywhere, anytime. So it became unbearable. So I would say that when I was not successful, my relationships weren't so bad. Because, like I said, in an indifferent father's case, there is still a lot of trust. There is still a lot of faith and occasional nurturing, right? But an evil sibling, there is loss of desire. First of all, you feel a certain loss of desire between the, you know, like, you know, your couple life. You feel that the man is more focused on competing with you, proving you wrong, crushing you and your ego, and completely demolishing you. And there is not even little bit trust left. So I don't know what evokes this in a man, but it's been horrible. After my success, my relationship has gone completely for a toss.
Wow. So, in fact, I remember casually chatting with you once and I asked you, Kangana, you are so successful now. There's articles about the highest paid actress, so many awards, any award you want, you've got it. What would you have more of today? More success or more love?
Well, we want to be successful for love, right?
Is that true? Is that you want to be successful for love?
Absolutely. There is no other reason to life, is there? Like if a man wants to be an achiever, for more admiration, for more love, a woman doesn't have any other reason for anyone to feel that a woman has another agenda behind wanting to be successful or earn money, or she's ambitious, so she has some agendas, you know. There's no agenda, it's simply for love, for more admiration, for wanting to be seen as your abilities, not as like a 55 kgs weight that you carry, right? I want to be seen as my abilities, my skills, like the artist I am, you know. I want to be seen as my qualities, not as the girl, like I said, 55 yeah. kgs.
You're only 55 kgs. I'm so jealous, actually. We are all very jealous of your weight. But so seriously, you would rather have more love than more success, and you're saying you don't have enough love. Kangana Ranaut, one of the most beautiful desirable woman in the country doesn't have love. Guys, what are you doing? Seriously.
Thank you.
You really feel that? Is it because of certain relationships that have made you feel that way? That people have let you down or you're not lovable enough or something?
Well, like I said, you know, when I wasn't successful, then I wasn't good enough. And when I became successful, I became the person to compete with, you know. So where is the time for love? Do you see, like, you know, but like I said, there are plenty of men out there. We still have a lot of hope. Look at you. He supports his wife. He's, you know, like, I think we need more examples like this. And I think when our leading men, when an author like Chetan Bhagat is going to write about a woman's journey, you know, from a daughter's point of view, a mother's point of view, a sister's point of view, it's going to make a lot of difference. And I want to ask you, this brings me to this question that usually, because I am a certified screenwriter, and when I read any writer's work, I can tell that whether they have delved into the psyche of the character or not. So when I read this, initially I do not take, you know, women character written by men very seriously. And that's why most of my director let me work on my character and flesh them out on my own. So when I read this, I'm like, kya likha hoga, let me read it, you know, like that.
Okay.
But after I read it, I was so impressed, and I asked him that, didn't it scare you to enter the psyche of a woman? Because every writer knows when we are done with the character, there's a part of any character, whether it's evil character, antagonist, protagonist, good, bad, child, a part of it remains in us. So how did you get that confidence from that I'm going to enter this woman's psyche? I'm going to have, you know, like, even going to enter her anatomy. I'm going to have, like, think, behave like a woman. And what if when the book is over, a part of her remains in me? It didn't frighten you.
It did, actually. Actually, you know, I've been wanting to write in a woman's voice for 8 to 10 years now. But I had no confidence because of the reasons you're saying. Because I didn't just want to write about a female character who's a detective. It's not a detective novel. It's a novel about women by a woman written by a man. And that requires a certain understanding and certain letting go of my, I can't explain the process. I have to let go of myself. I think you guys do it as actors sometimes. If you're working on a good script, you lose yourself. You are actually become somebody else. And I think it's a very similar process. This book, I went away. I wasn't even in India. I wrote most of this book in Hong Kong. I shut myself out completely. And I thought back at every woman I have known. And when, you know, normally women often scold you. They say, tumhe kuch samajh nahi aata hai. Ya, tumhe kya pata hai? Yeah, you don't understand me. I said, what was she trying to say to me? And I contacted them again. And I said, tell me, what did I not understand about you? And then I, without ego, without any sense of self, I just listened to her as if she's 100% right. And I did it with a lot of women. And I think over time, I just had to let go. Today, I do feel a sense of loss. Every time my book comes out, you want to hold on tight to that story one last time before it goes out to the world. I do feel like maybe I'm permanently become a woman a little bit after this book, which may not be a bad thing. You know, I felt like getting a pedicure this morning, and not just that, but I think there is a certain feminine side which I'm not so afraid of now. I'm afraid to take on uncertainty. I'm afraid to
Don't we love our husband taking care of our babies? Don't we love our husbands putting nail paints on our fingers? Don't we love our husbands to appreciate our haircut? He's a perfect husband material, ladies and gentlemen. Clapping for Chetan.
No, but Kangra, you are... before we end this, you have been... I'll tell you honestly, you've been praising me a lot, and I'm now going to praise you for 2 minutes. So please...
Please, I know everything that you want to say.
No, it means a lot that you like this book. I can tell you, I was writing this book and I was super nervous. Because immediately all the feminists... Because I'm writing about a feminist girl who's vulnerable, who's insecure, who wants to hold on to love, who takes a while to understand her feminist side. And I was scared that feminists will say, how can a girl who's a feminist be crying for a man, you know? How can a girl who's a feminist be devastated by a breakup because a man left? And when you read it, it's not just you're a big star who read it, you're also one of the top feminist voices in the country. So to get your endorsement, I think it just, it's made the book today. After that, I totally relaxed and I wish you more success.
It's all heart.
No, no, and I wish you so much more success and so much more love. May you get a designer-made guy who will cater to your every whim and because you deserve it. But
no,
yeah.
I have one more question.
But talk to me about that. That you said to me it's the first feminist love story I've seen.
Yeah.
It's the first feminist...
No, I have one question which I will actually want to ask. I've been meaning to ask an intelligent man. I didn't come across any for a while. So now that we are here, so
what about, you mean you've not dated intelligent men?
No, for a while.
For a while.
I haven't come across. So this question I want to ask, that there is this relationship I was in and I was dating this guy who's not an actor. He's a doctor. And for us, though I was a few years ago, I was in my mid-20s, he's a young doctor, but I still made a lot more money than him. For me, it was nice to go back to that environment where I actually grew up in, you know. Real people, real environment. It was little, you know, it took me aback to lose my identity, like, because they were white people. He's an English guy. For me, it was a little hard to sort of come to a world where I'm just, you know, like leading an anonymous life. But I still came to terms with it. It was hard for him to adjust to my environment. Though I don't have hanky-panky filmy friends, all my friends are very humble. But every time he'd meet my friends, he would ask me, what did your friends think of me? Am I some small fry? He never spoke like that, you know? And it was so heartbreaking to see him under that kind of a stress. So I remember one incident when we were in London and how your movie star friends suggest you places that to go to, you know, like one of the best restaurants in the world and all of that. So I said that, you know, we should go here. And he Googled and he's like, I don't want to spend so much on food. I said, I want to go there and I want to pay for it. Can I? Because he liked paying for everything. He seemed okay with that. We went there, we had dinner, it was amazing. When it came to paying for the food, I swiped the card and everything, and he started to get psyched in a very unnatural way. You know, like he would ask me, what is this waiter thinking about me? I said, do you know the waiter? And he's like, no, but even that lady was looking at us. I said, do you know that lady? He's like, why do men do that? And that was that dinner became like a trauma, and I'm sure it was equally traumatic for him as well, because it led to a, you know, like an argument and then fight, and I cursed myself for even suggesting that I want to pay, you know. But if I can do laundries for him, go back to an anonymous life, being, you know, like a major movie star, he cannot come to terms with my environment, even if it is for like half an hour. Why do men do that?
Okay. So I'm not going to defend men, and I'm not going to make this about men versus women, but I do want to tell you one thing. Just as women are conditioned to be a certain way, men are also culturally conditioned. You know, masculinity is not discussed much. It's just told, a man is told, you are what you earn. You are the money you make. And when you make your money, you take care of your woman. And that's so ingrained in a man that it, for many men, it's part of their identity. Unless you're Besharam like me, mujhe koi fark nahi padta.
It's not Besharam, right? Like if he's my partner.
I know.
I mean...
No, jokes apart. And I think men are told that this is what it means to be a man. You need to be able to... You should always pay in a restaurant. And maybe in that restaurant, even the waiters always every day see the men paying, especially when a beautiful girl comes. And I think he felt small. Should he have felt too small? No. I think if he was secure about the relationship with you, he would have not felt small. But I think it was not about the money. It was not about who's paying. It seems like this man was afraid to lose you. He felt that I'm not man enough for her, and she, like every other woman, will care that I never pay or I'm not able to afford.
But then how to have relationship, a healthy relationship, with your partner when you can't always pretend to be, you cannot pretend to be a nobody all the time, right? Like, for how long I can go on with a sort of facade that, oh fine, I'm just like another girl, I am not a movie star,
I am not this
capable person, and I do not visit fancy restaurants. I cannot go on pretending, like, right? That's not natural.
That's the issue at large, and that's what the book deals with as well. I think in some ways we have changed. So we have colleges, we have jobs, we have opportunities that a girl can come from an ordinary background and become very successful, whether it's a banker, scientist, doctor, or a movie star. But when they actually become successful, society, the social structures have not changed. We don't know what to do with them. Every man wants a girl who's not more successful than her. Now what will happen to Kangana? Inke liye aadmi kahan se banega? Right? So then she's like now saying, I need more love. Arey, what is happening? The moment I start getting awards, my boyfriends start getting insecure. So it's not her fault. Whereas for a man, when he wins an award, the girl is expected to...
I will organize a party for him. But when I get an award, you know, I became the object of suspicion that, you know, okay, now what's going on with her, you know?
That's a dilemma, and I think that's what this book is trying to understand. Address that you've made, given women the opportunity to shine. We always keep saying empower the woman. There's a scene in the book where the girl tells her mother, why did daddy tell me when I was a little child we used to
That line just made me cry. I was like, you know, sobbing like a little girl when I read that. It's so powerful.
So she just says that dad used to tell me, bete bade ho ke tum kuch bhi ban sakte ho, you can be anything in life. And now I'm successful, now I'm making so much money. My mom is saying, you're not even a girl anymore. Tu chupchap ghar baith ke shaadi kyun nahi karti?
Yeah, because mom tells her that she cannot put her so many zero salary in her matrimonial. Because
less guys. So they're making a shaadi.com matrimonial for her. And mom says, no. The girl makes around 2-3 crores a year. She says, don't put your salary. Then we don't get good boys. So she says, mom, what is the point of my achievements if you're going to hide them?
Yeah, exactly. And that's when she says this. And this is, I think, is the most amazing part of the book.
And the bankers can hide achievements. But how is Kangana supposed to hide her achievements? They'll just read about it in the papers. So that's it. I think on that note, we'll do a very quick read. I don't like to do long readings. And my readings are also like dialogue. So I will read the boys' part and Kangana will read the girls' part. Normally, I've always written as a boy, so I can guide it because it's a first person boy. But this time it's going to be a little different because it's as a girl, so obviously Kangana has to read as a girl. So she'll be reading the girl's dialogues and the description and narrative. Those of you who have the book in their hand, page 13, chapter 2, page 13, around the second paragraph, the scene is, it's a destination wedding happening. So the girl, Radhika, has met the arranged marriage guy she's getting married to. So she's not in love with him yet. It's just an arranged marriage guy who works in Facebook in IT department. She doesn't have a relationship with him or anything yet. And they are in Goa and they decide that let's spend some time together. So the boy says, let's go for a walk on the beach. So this is the first meeting with this boy, Brijesh. You guys see chapter 2, page 12?
Also, I'll use two voice modulations.
Yeah.
One for Radhika, another for Mini-Me, which is she has a voice inside of her, like a nagging, criticizing. Would you introduce Mini-Me, please?
So there is a mental Radhika and there is a speaking Radhika. So Kangana will do both. Okay. Okay. So they are taking a walk. Kangana, from So You Just. Yeah.
Okay. So you just arrived yesterday from San Francisco.
Yeah, I landed last night. I wanted to maximize my leave. 1 week for the wedding, a couple of days after that at home in Mumbai, then Bali for our honeymoon. Used it all up, actually.
The word honeymoon caused a jolt in me. Mini-Me woke up again. Honeymoon? After a dozen old Skype calls, meeting once over a day trip, a week in Bali with this man I am walking next to, will we be naked? Stop it, Radhika. Focus on the moment. Must be tiring, flying so much.
I saw you. I'm not tired anymore.
I smiled. The man is trying. Maybe I should too. Brijesh smiled back. He had innocent teacher's pet eyes. How's Facebook?
I had a busy month. Just finished an enterprise project. So much work. Front-end interfaces, back-end systems, underlying APIs.
APIs?
Application program interface. You know, it's a set of routines, protocols, tools for building software applications. How software components interact, basically.
I nodded, having understood not a word.
You have no idea what I'm talking about, right?
I laughed. I know, not the...
I know. Not the most exciting job in the world.
Come on, you work at Facebook. It's quite cool.
People think it is Facebook, so there's nothing to do. We post pictures all day or something.
Oh, I'm sure. It is pretty high-tech behind the scenes. Should I talk more about personal stuff? He will happily discuss computer code for 2 hours if I let him. Radhika, take control.
Okay, I think we'll stop here. Rest, you have to read the book. Big hand for Kangana to do this. Is it okay to do one or two questions from people?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so we'll do 2-3 questions from here and then we'll launch the book and then we'll have Kangana has to leave and then I'll be here to sign the books. So please queue up. No pictures, just simple. They'll tell you how the signing works.
This time we've got the hard copy books over here. There are also e-books now available. What are your comments on your satisfaction with e-books or with physical books? What's your take on that?
Well, I come from little old school. I love physical books. Though e-books are not bad either. When you're traveling, you can't carry a lot of them together. But my eyes start to hurt after a while with the light and all of that. Yeah.
Okay,
we'll throw it open. Just one more from the media. Two more from the media.
Give them a mic, no?
I just read the excerpt that was put out, which is about the waxing scene. And you kind of describe the waxing scene and it's pretty close to real life. And at the end, you say something on the lines of how Radhika would have preferred lashes that they give in Saudi Arabia to waxing. Do you think that's a very dangerous comparison to make?
It's just a joke. Because she's never had waxing done. So when she gets it done, she feels like she's getting lashes in Saudi Arabia. Which they give to us. So it's just a joke. But yeah, it's okay. I take creative liberties, so it's just that. Any questions for Kangana?
Okay, one question on the back.
Yeah.
Hi. That's nice. Thank you.
Hi, sir. My name is Gavi.
That's nice. Thank you.
Yeah, yeah.
My nice. Question Thanks. Is that you have created a character who is feminist and who is a free girl. So how do you explain the character to accept a arranged marriage proposal?
I just read the book. You will see what's going on. I don't want to reveal much about the book. Yeah.
We'll take one from the right, one from the left now, and we'll sum it up.
Hi, Jetan. Congratulations for your book. I've been to 2 launches before as well, and many congratulations. Coming straight to the question. All your books have become really successful. Do you feel the pressure, you know, when every time there's a book launch, everyone is aware it's going to be super?
I do. But this time after Kangana said she loved the book, I was not so worried.
But do you generally feel the pressure when you're writing?
Until she had the book, I was worried. I do feel pressure, especially when I'm writing it and when I'm taking such a risky subject, I do. Okay. Guys, you have any questions for Kangana? Then she has to go. Okay.
Kangana, you being a successful woman, how difficult is it to be in a relationship with another successful man who is from the same industry? Like, how difficult is that?
Like I said, you know, I just explained that equations change. When you're not successful enough, then you are devalued. And when you become successful, then there is a competition spirit that creeps into you, into both of you. And I don't know if it is actually about the profession, because like I said, I've dated a guy who's not from the same profession as well, but there was this constant tension between us every time matter of monies came up, filing tax, or even one dress of mine, how much it costs, you know, and everything was like as if I was trying to hide, just to not, you know, like literally walking on eggshells, not to, you know, hurt egos. But it's very hard. It's very hard to find someone who can hold his own before you when you're so successful.
Kangana, you have this image, what I've seen in your talks and speeches is like you're this feminist, and today you're coming across as really like just a simple girl who needs love, isn't it? And can you connect the two? Can you be that and a feminist together? Because I think girls here want to know.
No, I think I personally feel that how you have given this very beautiful name to feminism, he has actually changed feminism into humanism. The first day he came to me, he said that there is nothing called feminism. It's humanism. If you're a human, you know, you would consider other human as well. And as far as a convenient life that I want somebody to do up my laundry and, you know, cook food for me and iron my clothes, you know, that even women need that sort of luxury. It's not that we don't, you know. So in the name of, you know, so I think that name that you've given, feminism, humanism, I completely agree with. And I think what I want to tell women is that I think for centuries now women have been exploited in the name of sacrifice, that, you know, if you're a nice woman and if you are a fair woman, you know, you would sacrifice your services in the name of family and children. I think there's nothing called sacrifice. If a woman contributes to a family and builds up a family together with a man and invests in his career and lets him build his career for their better future, it's a contribution, it's a full-time job. If I leave my job and decide to be a housewife, that doesn't mean I'm sacrificing, because sacrifice doesn't demand anything in return, right? So I feel housewives are not given their respect every time, at least in my experience, a housewife asks for money, you know, she's not given for her honor, as if, you know, she's asking for herself. And a woman who works and a woman who has, you know, she's not given that kind of love and care and trust which housewives enjoy. So housewives are not given dignity and career women are not given trust and love. So I think we today as modern women are very conflicted. We have to decide between, you know, whether to choose either, you know, but I don't think it's any, you know, rational thinking, because if tomorrow I choose to be, like today, if I choose to raise a family, I would want respect and honor in return for my contribution. I am investing the best years of my life into raising a family. So I need my respect along with care and love. And if I'm a career woman, I choose not to have babies and I choose not to have marriage or get married, not have babies, or have babies, not get married, I still want the same kind of trust, just because I can survive in cutthroat competition, just because I can demolish people and rise like a phoenix, doesn't mean I can't be trusted, doesn't mean I can't be loved, doesn't mean I'm not worthy of mothering my offsprings, you know, it doesn't say none of this. So I think this book, in a very romantic way, not in a harsh way, like I'm speaking like really matter of fact, but it's been put in a story, and I think I really appreciate this, saying important things than actually saying in your face.
But as a woman, final question.
Kangana, you know, I've had so many people launch books over the years, and when you are speaking, it doesn't feel like I've got a Bollywood actor. It feels like I have an intellectual who's launching the book. So she's India's most beautiful intellectual, clearly. And while it's totally up to you whether you want babies or not, it's your choice. But I hope you do, because your babies will be so cute, especially if they have those curly hair. So please, I hope they come to the world soon, and I'm sure they will. But thank you once again. I think we'll just do the formal launch once. Yeah.
Sir, last question. Last question to Kangana is, Kangana, you have always stood for what's right. And recently Rakesh Roshan said that even when someone is spreading lies about him.
This is not the place for that.
No, but I want to know, why can't Indian men stand up for themselves? He's a 43-year-old son. Why his father has to come for his rescue always? No, for how long, father? They will keep hiding behind their influential big names, father. He's an adult. He can pretty much handle his own controversies in show business. It's just a simple controversy. Why daddies have to always, you know, save their sons? I don't understand this.
Thank you very much, Kangana.
All right.